Yeah, we talked about extrema in multidimensional spaces, and in particular about extrema under constraints. And here we have the central theorem about how to find these extrema under the constraints. So we have a function f depending on n variables. Is that true? Yes, yes. And a constraint h, which is, I mean, this h is a vector valued function with p values, or in other words, we can have p constraints. Yeah? We can have a number of constraints, and p is the number of constraints. Yeah? And for each one of the constraints, I have one function. So these functions are h1, h2, and so on. Yeah? And now this is the proposition. If there is an extremum of f under the constraints, there exist real numbers, lambda 1 through lambda p, such that this equation, this set of equations holds. Yeah? And this set of equations is called the Lagrangian equations. Yeah. And what you can see here is we have the partial derivatives of f with respect to xi and of h with respect to xi. And these parameters lambda k. And now we see, here we have n equations for n plus p unknowns. We have the unknowns x1 through xn, and we have the lambdas as additional unknowns, and therefore we need p extra equations, but we do have them. These are just the constraints. And so we have n plus p equations for n plus p unknowns. That's what we saw last time. Okay, and now, this is the Lagrange function. Yes, let's look at this again. So our f plus the sum lambda k hk, this is called the Lagrangian function. And our equations, our set of equations we have to solve becomes very easy if we use this terminology of the Lagrangian function, because then our equations are just the partial derivatives of the Lagrangian plus the constraints. Huh? If you take the partial derivative of this, then you immediately get these equations. Okay, now let's look at an example. We have this function, f, under this constraint. I mean, the first thing you always do when you have to solve such a problem, try to understand it. And this means try to draw a picture. And that's the picture. The black lines are the contour lines of f. And the red line is the constraint. We have one constraint. I mean, these contours of f, look at this, are circles, obviously. And our f function is a bowl, which is shifted upwards from the origin. And this is our constraint. Now let's look at the constraint. This is a parabola. And that's what you see here. And now where are our extrema given these constraints? I mean, we immediately see them in this picture. There is a maximum here. and there is a minimum here and a minimum there. That's it. These are the three constraints. And I asked you to go hiking over the weekend and use such a topographic map. If you did this, then you immediately see what's going on. Okay, now how to do the mathematics here? I mean, this is straightforward. It's really a straightforward procedure, just applying our recipe. Lagrangian function, this is f plus lambda times the constraint. Partial derivative with respect to x is this, to y is this. And now we have to set these two partial derivatives equal to 0, which is equivalent to setting the gradient to 0. And also we have our constraint equation. And that's what we get here. These two equations plus the constraint. So now here you see we have three equations for three unknowns. And if we solve them, then we get as a first solution x1 equals 0, 2. And let's go back to our picture. That's this point here. And we get two additional solutions, x2 and x3, which are these two guys. So we have y equal 1/2 and x positive and negative this value, and then these two points.
Mr. Yeah? I've got a question, because how I can see now where the minimas are in the contour plot? The maxima is clear, but the minima, for me, it's not clear to see it.
So it's clear that this is a maximum.
Yes, this is
a okay, I mean, if this is a maximum, then if we go along this trail here, it goes down. It goes down all the time because we are crossing the black contour lines. We are going down, 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 and here we are parallel to the contour, and it's going up again. So you haven't been hiking over the weekend?
No.
Okay, that's it. I told you, it's the last weekend with nice weather. Next weekend, you may already have snow in the mountains.
I have to learn mathematics.
That's okay, yeah. But I mean, that was one of your exercises. Okay, yeah. Here we have a next example. Again, I don't go into all the details. Let's look at f. This is our f function, and here we have the contour lines, which have a hyperbolic shape here. And this is due to this function. And we have now the constraint is kind of a little bit more difficult, because it is the closed unit circle around the origin. And what does that mean? Yeah, look at this set here. It's the set of all points with x squared plus y squared less than or equal to 1. So if we would just look at the circle, it's not the closed unit circle, it's the closed disk with radius 1. It's the disk. So it's the whole disk, all points inside this disk. If it would be the circle, we would have equal to 1. Okay, and so strictly speaking, we don't have an easy or a straightforward methodology to solve such problems. Because what we learned up to now was either finding extrema without constraints or finding extrema with an equality constraint. But what we do have here is now an inequality constraint. But it's not difficult, because we will do the following. We will apply both techniques. We will first look for an extremum or for all extrema without constraints. And that's what we do first. And then maybe we find a set of extrema. And then we will next look how many of these extrema are inside the disk. Not on the margin, inside the disk. Okay? And then we have found all the extrema inside the disk. And then we will look whether we have extrema on the margin. That's the procedure. Is that clear? Okay. Yeah. Oh, there. But first, let's look at the picture. So now, again, that's the question for the hikers. Huh? So we're hiking on this trail here. Are there maxima or minima on this trail? Yes, there are. How many? Two maxima, two minima. Yes. That's it. And yeah, that's actually a good question because we have to know whether it goes up here or down. How can we find this out easily? Does it go up or down here in this direction? Yeah?
I think it goes up because the gap between the lines are smaller at the outer point.
Oh, no. What you're saying is it gets steeper the farther you get away, but it may go steeper down. Yeah?
When we fill in zero for y.
Yeah, that's the right thing to do. Thank you.
The 4x squared. And the more we go to the outside, the higher
yeah.
it gets.
Yes, that's it. We said y equals zero, then we have 4x squared, so it goes up. It goes up like 4 times x squared if you go in positive x direction and in negative x direction too. Okay, so that means we have a maximum here, we have a maximum here, and here we have a minimum. But how about extrema inside the disk? Are there any extrema inside? No, there are none. Because, I mean, this point might be a candidate, and it is actually a candidate, because we will see that the gradient here is zero. But it's a saddle point. If you walk in this direction, it goes up in both on both sides, but here it goes down and here it goes down too. Okay, now let's do the formal part. of course we compute the gradient again, set it equal to zero, and we immediately see that the origin is the unique zero of the gradient. That's our candidate. Yeah? Now we compute the Hessian matrix of the gradient. And then, I mean, we can. There are two procedures to see whether it is positive or negative, definite or indefinite. Procedure one is to compute the subdeterminants, which is this determinant and the determinant of the whole matrix. So we get 8 as the first and minus 9 as the second subdeterminant. And so we see it's indefinite. But we also could could compute the eigenvalues of the Hessian. I don't go into the details. And what we get is 9 and minus 1 as the two eigenvalues, which shows that the Hessian is indefinite. Yeah? And if you look back in the script to our theorem about the Hessian matrix, it says if the Hessian matrix is indefinite at some point, then we definitely have no extremum at that point. Yeah? Okay, yeah. And maybe that's interesting too. Look, this Hessian matrix is a 2x2 matrix with these four numbers. But the interesting thing is that no x or y appears inside the Hessian matrix. And this is not normal. Typically, we may have x and y inside the Hessian matrix. But here, this is not the case. What is the reason? Because our gradient already consists of linear functions. And if you take the derivative of a linear functions, then all x's and y's disappear. So the Hessian is constant, yeah? And that's why here we say F has no local extremum on any open set D. No matter where, our F can have no extremum. So we don't even need to check at our candidate point in the origin, because we know from just looking at the Hessian, F can have no extremum. If there would be in our Hessian some x's and y's, what would we have to do in the next step? No, the Hessian is already a second derivative. We would have to substitute for x and y our candidate, which is 0, 0. Yeah? But here we don't have to, because the Hessian is constant. Okay. Yeah, and now we look at the margin of our disk, which is the circle. So now this is our function. This is our constraint, which is the unit circle. We get this Lagrangian. We take the first derivatives. And this gives us these three equations. Three equations, three unknowns. And we will solve these three equations. We can, for example, multiply the first equation by y and the second by x. And this, so what gives that? Yeah, we get this equation. But why did I do this? Good question. Oh yes, why did I do this? Obviously. The lambda should cancel out, but let me see. There is something wrong here. So this must be a y, is that correct? The second here, L with respect to y gives us 3x plus 2 lambda y. Yes, this must be a y, and this must be a y too. And then if we multiply this with y and this with x, then the lambda term cancels out. And now we have this equation with no lambda, but with x and y. And what we then do is we take the constraint, solve it for y squared, and replace this here. And then we get this equation. And this is an equation for x only. One variable left, which is quite nice. But we do have a square root in this equation. Now what we can do next is, or what we typically would do is, we bring the term with the square root on one side of the equation, or we bring all these guys to the right hand side, and then we square the whole equation. But what's not so nice is then we get a fourth order equation. Huh? But this is not so bad because here we only have x squared. Huh? So if we square the whole thing, we get terms with x to the fourth power, and we get a term with x squared. But this is not so bad because now we can substitute x squared by some new variable u, and then we have a quadratic equation. And that's what happens here. If we substitute x squared equal to u, we get this equation. Huh? And now if we square this equation, then the square roots go away, and here we have 64u times 1 minus u, and the square of the right-hand side, and then we solve this quadratic equation. We get these two solutions. We do the back substitution for x square equal u, and we get these two values for x. 1 and 2 and these two. So, of course, we get four solutions. Huh? And fortunately, all four solutions are real numbers, no complex solutions. And, that's quite nice that we get four solutions because if you look at our picture, we have four extrema. Let's look. What are the x's? Plus and minus 0.3 and plus and minus 0.94. Yeah. So these are the minus 0.3, plus 0.3, and this is the minus 0.95 and the plus 0.95. And the only thing what's missing is we have to compute the corresponding y values. Okay, it looks like they are missing here. You can do that. To get such a contour plot, you can do this in MATLAB or Mathematica or GNUplot, but in the exam you can't use these computer tools, if you're on your vacation on the lonely island and you don't have your iPod or whatever, then you have to just compute it. So you set the function equal to a constant, the contour level, solve it for y, and now you have a function, and then you do an analysis of the function, and you can plot the contour line diagram. Here we have the y values. For x3 we get this, and so on. And so that's how we get these solutions. And here it says, F has on the unit circle, in this point and in this point, an isolated local maximum, and in the other two points, an isolated local minimum. And here, the analysis, how do we get to this answer where we have a minimum and a maximum. I mean, here I just used what we have seen in the picture. Yeah? But of course, this is a good question. Is there a strict and formal method that tells us whether such a candidate is a maximum or is a minimum or neither of them? Yeah? This is the answer. It's a so-called bordered Hessian matrix. Let's just look at this matrix. First, here we have such a square, which is just zeros. And second, what we see now is that here only appears the constraint, or the constraints. So we have p, a number of constraints, h1 through hp, and so this is the column, and in one row we have all partial derivatives of each of the constraints. Or, I mean, you could also say this here, this matrix here is the Jacobian of our constraint. And this is the transpose of the Jacobian of the constraint. And what we have here, this is the Hessian matrix of the Lagrangian function. Yeah. I mean, this is a generalization for the case where we have constraints. So in the special case that our constraints are, that we have no constraints, so p equals zero, then this must end up in the Hessian function of our function f. And is that the case here? Of course it is. Why? So if p is equal to zero, then we can just delete it. If p is equal to zero, then we delete this, and this. Okay. So what's remaining is this square matrix, which is the Hessian of the Lagrangian. But it's the Lagrangian, it's not our function f, or is it? Yes, it is f. Why? Because the Lagrangian function is f plus lambda times the constraints, f plus the sum of lambda I times the constraints. But if we have zero constraints, then the sum is empty, and then the Lagrangian is equal to f. Okay, so we have to compute, the first step, of course, is first derivatives, finding all the zeros, and then we have the candidates. And now the question is, what do we have to do with our candidates and this bordered Hessian matrix in order to find out whether these candidates are maxima or minima? And here you see the theorem, the result. We have a local maximum of f under the constraint h if the Hessian matrix, the bordered Hessian, the determinant of the bordered Hessian is positive. And we have a local minimum if the determinant of the bordered Hessian is negative. And you see, I mean, you really have to be careful. So the situation is somewhat different. Before, without constraints, we just looked at the definiteness of the matrix. Now, we don't look at the definiteness anymore. We just look at the determinant of the bordered Hessian matrix. Yes. But, oh, is that true? Oh, I have to check it. I am pretty sure that this simple proposition here only holds for the two-dimensional case. Oh yeah, let's go back. Yeah. No, but this bordered Hessian what we have here is, yeah, this is the n-dimensional case. Okay. Yeah, I mean it's not absolutely clear, because here we start talking about the two-dimensional case, yeah, and this holds for the two-dimensional case. So please make a remark. This is only valid for the two-dimensional case. There is a statement for the n-dimensional case, but this is not really easy. That's much more complicated than just looking at the definiteness of the matrix. Yeah, I mean, here you can see, we are talking about the two-dimensional case because we have x and y as arguments here. Okay, yeah. And it is similar to the case without constraints. If the determinant is equal to zero, then we cannot decide. Then we know nothing. Okay. Yeah. And now this is the application to example 331. Which one was this? Yeah, so that's the application to this example. What was the gradient here? Yeah, this was the gradient. So please remember this. And now we compute the Hessian. Yeah, here we have the gradient again. And this is our bordered Hessian matrix. And now we have, and now you see here in this bordered Hessian matrix, there is an x remaining. So now we have to look at the particular points. And if we take the first solution of grad L equals 0, which was x equals 0, y equals 2, so now we replace x equals 0 in here. And we get this matrix, and the determinant of this matrix is 6, which is positive, and therefore we have a local maximum in this point. And if we substitute the other 2 points, we have a minimum. Oh, this is not shown here. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So that's it about really short and fast repetition of analysis. Yeah. Of course, this is only a small part of multidimensional analysis, but that's what you may need during your master courses. Yeah.
Explain how we get the lambda.
The lambda, oh yes, how do we get the lambda equal minus 4? Yeah, we have to go back to the example. Where is it? Okay. Yeah. Look, here we have the equations. And in this equation, you see lambda. And that means lambda is minus 2 times y, and y is 2, so we get minus 4. Any other questions? Okay, so now let's make a fast sweep through the exercises. Okay, and we come to the next chapter, which is statistics and probability. And again, I mean, what comes here is really basic. What I did in the script is I included quite some stuff into the script, but I will not present everything here. So if all I present here is easy for you, maybe you can skip the script. If not, maybe you should really look in detail into the script. Maybe even into a book. Why not? But I mean, this also holds for all the other chapters. Okay, so here in this definition, we just define the term of a sample. What is a sample? It's a series of measurements of some random variable x. So n values of some variable x. Here, let's immediately go to an example. So what I took is, but these are not real results. They are, suppose the grade of some exam in mathematics 1 gave us these results, these grades. Huh? This set of grades. And we call our variable x. And then, I mean, we have these grades occur in our sample. And now some grades occur more than once. Maybe this one, 2.2, occurs three times. Here we have the absolute frequency. And then here we have the relative frequency, which is nothing but the absolute frequency divided by n. And n is the total number of samples. And now what is the advantage of dividing this absolute frequency by n? And the advantage is that now we can use this as an estimate for a probability. And why? Because the sum of all these values is equal to 1. Yeah. And that's, of course, what we require for a probability measure. The sum of all probabilities must be 1. Okay, but it's very important to know that these numbers are no probabilities. Why are these numbers no probabilities? That's important for the following. We have to distinguish between probabilities, real probabilities, and sometimes it's called empirical probabilities. But what's even better is these guys here are just estimates. We estimate a probability. I mean, look, we have a sample, a really small sample, and this grade occurs three times. Would you now believe that the probability for a student passing this exam with a 2.2 is equal to 0.13? I mean, if we talk about a probability, then this is the probability for a student passing this exam. And this can then be used as a prediction on average in the future. The probability for having this grade would be this number. Of course, we can't be sure that this is true, because we here have a small finite sample size. Probability is always a limit for sample size towards infinity on a representative sample. Okay, so, And we can define the empirical distribution function, capital H of x, which is the sum of all t less than or equal to x h of t. Okay. We will look at an example in a few minutes of this. Okay, yeah, we don't have to look at this text. Yeah, here we have this. Here we have it. Yeah? So here we have our grade on this axis, and here we have our h of x, which is our estimate for the probability, and then we get these dots, and what we have here is our empirical distribution function, which is the sum over all values less than or equal to x. So if we take, for example, this x here, which is 2.2, then let me see. Yeah, we have to look at the definition again. It's for all values less than or equal to x. Okay. Now, if we go at 2.2, which is here, then this is the value. It's the sum over. So here we have 2.2. We sum up, which is 0.04 plus 0.04 plus 0.13 something, and thus we get this value. Yeah. And that's why this empirical distribution function is monotonically increasing, because it's a sum of positive values. And it starts here in this corner at 0 and ends up here at 1. Yeah, here. Okay. Yeah, and now I want to talk to you about how to graphically visualize such a sample. And I took an example. Yeah, this is actually an example, quite old, from my PhD thesis. How long is that ago? That was in 1992. Yeah. And in my thesis, we developed AI programs, and these were randomized programs that used random numbers. And when you use such a randomized program, then the running time of the program may depend on these random numbers. So it may happen that, and these were search algorithms, it may happen that by chance it's very fast, but also it may happen that it's very slow. So we get a distribution of running times between almost zero and some quite big number, which is 50,000 something steps. And here we have the frequency. The frequency plotted over the running time. I mean, what's very nice, and that was actually a topic of my thesis, to understand the shape of these distributions. Yeah? And that was quite nice. This is the expected value. And we have this distribution looks quite symmetric, and here also quite symmetric to this point, and so on. But here I don't talk about these programs. We talk about how to visualize such a distribution. And this is an empirical distribution. And so we don't have infinitely many data. And that's why, I mean, maybe this cluster theoretically is the same as this one. But you see, we have a frequency of 4 here, and of 3, and 2, and 1. but here we only have 1 and 2. I mean, that's just because it's empirical. But we can look at the same distribution a little bit differently. So here we took for any point here of the running time, we just draw the exact number, how many samples do we have for any point. But maybe it gets better if we take some intervals and just count how many samples we do have in some finite interval. And yeah, in the next picture, in this picture, we took intervals of a width of 70. So that means from here to 10,000, we have around 140 intervals. And now, the same sample looks like that, which is quite different. And I would say this gives us more information because we can see that the structure of the distribution much better. We can make these intervals even bigger if we take 700 as an interval, which means we only have 14 such intervals in this region, then it's this what we get. I mean, we get an even better resolution in the y direction now, but we lose the resolution on our time axis. I mean, we don't see these clusters anymore. So if we go back here, we have a better resolution. We have 140 points in this region, and here we really see these gaps. And here we have an even better solution on this axis, but we lose the resolution on that axis. So, I mean, this is, you need some feeling for your data, and then you will find a good value to display your data in the appropriate way. And of course, it also depends on what you want. Okay. Now, I mean, statistics is much about reducing data. You collect 1 million of samples of something, and if somebody asks you what is the result of your statistics, you could print this 1 million samples on paper and give such a bunch of paper to this person who asks you, but maybe the person wouldn't be happy. Because we always want to get a short and easy answer. And in the ideal case, we want to know just one number. And that's the idea behind statistics, to compile our samples in ideally just one number. And one such number is the arithmetic mean, which of course everybody knows, which gives us a mean value of our sample. But a different number is the sample median. Now, I think I don't have to explain the arithmetic mean. This is obvious to everybody. But what is the median? Here is the formula. Let's go back to our example here. This is the arithmetic mean where we have this triangle here. And what is the median? The median is the point on our horizontal axis here where half of the sample is left of the point and half of the samples is to the right. So now, what would you say, where is the median in this example here? Yeah? No?
It's too much to actually see, but I would guess it's around where this triangle is.
Around where this triangle is. It may be, yes. I don't know either. Yeah? But it may be at a quite a different point. Where may it also be? I mean, for the arithmetic mean, we all agree that this is reasonable, this point, or maybe quite close around here. But the median may be at some... So the area where the median may be is quite bigger. The median may be in this cluster, or in this cluster, somewhere here, or at any point in between. Why? The median is the point where half of the samples are to the left, and the other half is to the right. And because this is an empirical distribution, we don't know. I mean, how many samples was it all together? Does it say somewhere? No, I don't know it. So suppose it would be 1,000 samples, then it may happen that here we have 520 and here 480, then the median is somewhere here. If it's the other way around, the median is somewhere here. If it's exactly the same in both clusters, then the median is in the middle. I mean, you might say, oh, but this is a median point too. And in order to see what's true, we look at the definition. Here we have the definition. If n is odd, so we distinguish between odd and even sample size. If n is odd, for example, if we have three samples, so on such an axis, oh, should we make the light on? X1, X2, X3, then of course this is the median. Because one sample is smaller and one sample is bigger. Now let's take sample number 4, X4. Now in principle, anything between these two guys may be a median, but in order for this definition to be unique, we just take the middle between these two guys. And that's what this formula says. No? So here the median is at this point. Okay. Yeah, okay, yes. Now, the arithmetic mean, this formula, has the nice property that it minimizes the sum of the squares of the distances to the arithmetic mean. That's the point. So if we are looking for a point here on this axis where the sum of the squared distances to all our samples is minimal, then the solution for this is the arithmetic mean. And that's not really difficult to derive. What must we do? I mean, this is the function, the sum of the squares of the distances we want to minimize. What must we do in order to show or to get a formula for the arithmetic mean. Oh no, for that point which minimizes the sum of the squared distances. Maybe you should do that. So sum I equal 1 through n xi minus x squared, and we are looking for this point x which minimizes this function. Now what to do? We take the derivative with respect to x and set it equal to 0. That's it. And then we will get the arithmetic mean as a solution. Please do it as an exercise, because we will actually do this in a little bit more difficult context quite soon. And what's interesting too is that the median minimizes the sum of the absolute values of the distances. Okay. But sometimes we want to know more about our distribution than just the mean. I mean, look at this. Let's take two examples. If I tell you this is the mean of my data, then you know, okay, these data must be distributed somehow around this point. But the distribution may look like that. It may also be something like that. You have no idea how far they scattered around this point. And in order to get an idea about the deviation from the mean, we look at the variance. This is the empirical variance, and the square root of the variance is the empirical standard deviation of the sample. And look, what is the variance? We take the sum over all xi, these are our sample points, minus the arithmetic mean. So it's this is the distance from the mean, and then we square this distance, the sum of the squared distances from the mean. So it's the average, kind of the average distance from the mean. Okay, but what's not so nice about the variance is that, look, in here, these are my samples. And suppose we have we measured some size x which was in the dimension meters, which was a length. And now if I compute the variance, then here we have meter, and we square the whole thing. So the variance now is in the dimension of square meters. And that's not so nice. Suppose we would do a statistics of all of the sizes of all students in this room. And then the average size would be maybe 1.72 meters. And the standard deviation would be maybe 0.05 square meters. Would that help you to know that the standard deviation is some square meters? No. And that's why we take the square root of it, because then we could say the standard deviation is 5 centimeters, and maybe that would help you more. Okay, yeah. I mean, this was about one-dimensional samples. Quite often you have multi-dimensional samples. That means you don't measure just one variable, you measure many variables, x1 through xk. And then you have So our first measurement of all our variables is x11 through xk1 and so on up to sample number n. Yeah. Okay, and now let's look at our grades example. So now we take two different math lectures during your master's, for example. Yeah, we have math 1 and math 2. And now here we have the grade of math 1 and this is the grade of math 2. And on one line, we have one student. Yeah? So this is one particular student who had these two grades. Yeah? And here we have some other student with two different grades. Okay, and I mean, we actually did here at our university such analysis because we were interested, actually not with two different math grades here, but we were interested, oh, that's Richard, you did it. Didn't you do this with these students here quite recently? I mean, we wanted to classify the universities where the students came from, and then we look at the admission grade, yeah, which was maybe the average about whatever grades you had from your previous university, and then we want to know if you have an excellent grade when you come here, if these students who come here with the excellent grade will have a 1.0 in the math 1 lecture. Is there a correlation or is there no correlation? That's quite interesting because for the future we want to improve our procedure, the admission procedure for new students, because of course, as all universities, we would prefer the better students. Because we are not so happy if you don't pass the math exam. What we did here, or what one typically does then, is a correlation analysis. The question is there a correlation between these two variables? Between variable number one, which is admission grade, and variable number two, which is math one grade. And then we look at our sample in this way, and what we first calculate is the covariance. Yeah? Sigma xy, which is the covariance between variable x and variable y. Yeah? And what do we do here? So this is, of course, again, a sum over the whole sample set. And we have xi minus x squared. Okay, you see, so first we have to find the average of variable x. Then we have to find the mean, the arithmetic mean of variable y. That's what we have here. And now we look at the distance, the difference between each individual grade here and the mean. So let's take I equal 3, which is this student. So this is 2.2 minus the mean. The mean, I don't know, maybe it's 2.8 something. Yeah? So 2.2 is smaller than the mean, and then this is negative. Okay? And now what did the student have here? 2.8. Which is, what did I say? 2.8 is the mean, suppose, yeah. Then this would be 0, and then the whole product would be 0. But, yeah? Oh, yes, you're right, yeah. Sorry, then the second is 1.9, yeah. Okay, yeah, let's take I equal 3 because this is easy. Yeah? Because then both terms are negative. Both terms are negative and then the product is positive. And this gives us a positive contribution to the sum. Okay? Now suppose all the contributions to the sum are positive, then we get a positive covariance result. What does that mean? That means for all students, the deviation from the mean was in the same direction in both grades. It was like that. So here the student was better than average, and here it was also better than average. So if both values of one sample are smaller than average, we get a positive contribution. If they are both bigger than average, we also get a positive contribution. But if one is smaller than average, so the one student had maybe 2.0 in the one and 3.5 in the other, then this would be negative and this would be positive. The product would be negative, and we have a negative contribution to the sum. And if all contributions are negative, then the covariance is negative. And so in case of a positive covariance, we could say something like a typical student the better the student was in exam number one, the better it is in exam number two. So we have something like that. If the correlation is negative, then we would say the better a student is in exam number one, the worse it is in exam number two. So that's then what we could call an anti-correlation. Okay, yes, but this covariance has a little disadvantage. It is not normalized. I mean, we can say something about positive or negative, but if my positive value is, let's say, 3.7, then I don't know, is this really strong correlation or is it only weak? It depends on the absolute values, of course, of my xi. Yeah? And a normalized variant of this is the correlation. The correlation. So if I have two variables, I and j, so now they are no longer called x and y, because now we are talking about many variables. Huh? And if we take two out of many variables, and they are xi and xj, then this is the covariance. And now we normalize this covariance and define it, or call it the correlation, kij, which is sigma ij, divided by the two standard deviations. If we divide it by the two standard deviations, then this is normalized. And it is easy to prove that here we see it. It's easy to prove that the diagonal elements of the correlation matrix are 1, which means k, I are all equal to 1 for all I. That's easy to prove. You just replace it. You set y equal I, and then substitute this into here, and then you will immediately see. Okay, yeah. Let's look at these diagrams. What we have here is a so-called scatter plot. We have variable x here and variable y here. So just think back of our example here. This example, this is exactly our sample set with these two variables. And if you look at this scatter plot, then you see, I mean, we have kind of a cluster here. But this cluster is not exactly formed like a circle. It's a little bit squeezed in here, so it's kind of lengthy. And now if we would fit a straight line through these points, we will see how this works mathematically later on, then the straight line might look like this. And it's easy to see that this straight line would have a positive slope. A negative slope would be something like that. And if the slope is positive, this corresponds to a positive correlation coefficient. And if the slope is negative, it corresponds to a negative correlation coefficient. And it may even happen that our correlation is zero. And this is when there is kind of no straight line, so any slopes are equally possible. That's, for example, in this case. Look, here we have, I just took random numbers, pairs of random numbers, and plotted them. And here you can't see whether it's which slope would be preferred. So the correlation coefficient would be extremely close to zero here. Oh yeah, look. So we get as the covariance value 0.0025, yeah, which is close, very close to zero. Okay, yeah. So much about these simple parameters. Let's see. Yes, let's look at this example. I'm sorry, but with the AI students, you have seen this example already, but maybe it's not bad to see it again. This is a set of data which I had in an expert system project. We built an expert system for medical diagnosis to find out whether a patient has acute appendicitis. Appendicitis is about this such a little organ around here, which is quite often inflamed, and then you have to undergo surgery and remove the appendix. And we used 15 symptoms. The symptoms were like the leukocyte value, which is the number of leukocytes in some blood volume, or pain in some region of the abdomen, and so on. So we had 15 variables. These are the names of the variables. And these were represented in a file like that. First variable, for example, is the age of the patient. And so this is just one patient, next patient, and so on. And now what we have here, this is the correlation matrix. So we did in this project a correlation analysis because this is quite interesting and helpful to see whether some variables depend on each other. And here you can see all the values, which is not really easy to recognize what's going on. And that's why we used a density plot of these values. And in the left picture here, we have a density plot, and here a black value means we have a negative correlation. And if it's really black, it would be -1. If it's white, it means +1, a positive correlation. So we can see that, for example, here we have a negative correlation, and on the diagonal we have a positive correlations. And I already told you that all the diagonal elements are equal to 1. That's why they are all white. Sometimes you're not interested in whether it's a negative or a positive correlation. You just want to know whether two variables are correlated. And then maybe it's better to just plot the absolute values, which we had here. And so the really dark black squares are where we had a very weak correlation. And the white squares are those with very high correlation. Of course, I mean, the diagonal elements are not interesting, but maybe this one might be interesting, or this one might be interesting. And now let's look at this one. This is variable number 13 and 15. So, and now we can look. Variable number 13, which is leukocytes, and 15 is appendicitis. There is a strong correlation between the leukocyte value and the appendicitis, which is not at all surprising, because, I mean, the leukocytes are the white blood cells. And whenever some part of the body is inflamed, then your immune system reacts by increasing the number of white blood cells, and that's what we see in this correlation matrix. So it can be quite interesting to look at correlation matrices. It might even be interesting, I mean, this is a correlation, a second order correlation. Yeah? It might even be interesting to look at correlations of higher order, which is, for example, third order correlations. Now let's look at the formula. Yeah. So this is how to compute the correlations of two variables, xi and xj. Now, if you want to know the correlation of three variables, what would you do? You just multiply this by some third variable, xk. Yeah? And then you find triple correlations, which also may be quite interesting. But of course, then from this two-dimensional correlation matrix, we would come to a three-dimensional correlation matrix, and we would need 15 such plots to see all the levels of this three-dimensional matrix. Okay. Yeah, now let's look a little bit into probability theory. Not too much. Yes. So I just skip this and skip this. And let's start here. This is the classical so-called Laplacian definition of probabilities. This definition is, it's easy to understand, that's the advantage, but the disadvantage is it is not always applicable. This definition is always only applicable if the number of outcomes of your event of an experiment is finite. Look, why is this only defined for finite sets? Because, look, here we have the cardinality, the size of some set. And if it's infinite, then we would have infinite divided by infinite, and that's not really nice. Yeah? So, but for finite sets, so omega is the space of all our events. Yeah? So suppose we are talking about rolling a dice. Yeah? If we roll a dice, then we do have six different outcomes, which are the numbers 1 through 6. Yeah? And then here in the denominator, the amount of possible outcomes is 6. Yeah? And now we want to know the probability for rolling a 1. Yeah? How many chances do we have to roll a 1? It's 1. So then here, this size, the amount of outcomes favorable to our event A is 1. We have 1 over 6, and that's it. So this is really intuitive and easy. Yeah. Or here, a different example. the probability for throwing an even number is the size of the set of even numbers divided by the size of the set of all numbers, which is 3 divided by 6. That's 0.5. Okay. Now, I do not go into the axiomatic probability definition. I mean, you should look at it, but due to time reasons, we can't do that now. There is a number of easy consequences from this definition. Yeah. For example, let's look at this one. If we have two events which are pairwise inconsistent, that means the event A and the event B, they may not occur at the same time, then the probability for the union of A and B is the probability of A plus the probability of B. As an example, let's talk about the dice example again. And event A may be to throw an even number. The probability for this is 1/2. Event B, throw an odd number. Probability is 1/2 2. And the probability for the union of the two events then is 1. Yeah? Now let's take another example. Let's event A, even number, and event B, a number less than 3, less than or equal to 3, then the probability is 1/2 2, but the probability of the union, so an even number or a number less than 3, is not 1. Yeah? So that's why this only holds for inconsistent events. Huh? For any two events, A and B, the probability for the union is probability for A plus the probability of B minus the probability of the intersection of the two events. So now we can compute the probability for even number or number less than or equal to 3. What is the intersection? Which numbers less than or equal to 3 are even, which is 2. Yeah? So the probability of the intersection is 1 over 6. So the result is 1 minus 1 over 6, which is 5 over 6. Yeah? That's the probability for even number or less than or equal to 3. Okay, yeah, and for two complementary events, the sum of the probabilities is 1, yeah, and so on. Okay. Oh, yeah, proof as exercise. It's really a nice exercise to take the definition for probabilities, which is what we had here. I just omitted it. And from this definition, you can prove all these nice propositions. Conditional probabilities, we don't look into this example, we just look at the definition. This is the definition of a conditional probability, probability for A given B. This is the probability for A and B divided by the probability for B. Yeah. Now, here we're talking about independence of two events. Two events, A and B, are independent if P of A given B is equal to P of A. Is this intuitive? Can you explain why we call this such two events, A and B, independent? Is that how you learned the definition of independent events? No. Did you learn something different previously? Did you learn nothing previously? Maybe nothing. That's not so good. I mean, the everything we did up to now is what you already know. Or maybe should know. Now, why is this intuitively easy?
If they're in the bend, the intersection is zero.
No. It may be, but it need not. Yeah?
Necessary condition is that event B should occur first.
Should occur first? In time or what?
It should occur and then only the event B will occur, event A will occur.
No, forget it. Forget it. We should not talk about some time or causal dependence here. I mean, this is just about frequencies. Yeah? Okay, let me explain it. I mean, this is easy. That's just the probability for event A to occur. Okay? Let's take an example. Now let's roll two dice at the same time. And now the probability for dice one equal to six, so as to have a six as an outcome, is 1/6. Now the probability for dice 2 to be a 6 is also 1/6. Yeah? And now I ask you, what is the probability of dice 1 being a 6 given that dice 2 was a 6? One sixth, yes. And why?
1/6.
Oh, sorry. Why? Because they're independent. Because this is equal to P of D1 equals 6. Huh? But, so that's true if D1 and D2 are independent. Huh? Now, I mean, that's the question to the mechatronic student. Suppose now we are using big dices like that size. Huh? And now you can really build mechatronics inside. Huh? So some mechanics, you put some masses inside your dice and some little electric motors that can move the mass around. That's what you do in one dice. Huh? And in the other dice, you put some inertial sensors that tell you how it is. Is it a 1 on top, or a 2, or a 3, and so on. I mean, that's no problem. You just put a smartphone inside, and the smartphone knows always in which position it is. Huh? And you, of course, in dice number 2, you also put a smartphone and the motors with the masses. Huh? And then these two smartphones phones communicate all the time. And now you throw dice number 1. And dice number 1 knows how it ends up, and now it would tell dice number 2, please try to get the same number. Huh? And I mean, if you do a really nice mechatronics project, at the end, then you get a 1.0 grade if they always fall the same. Yeah? And now if, so suppose you get your grade 1.0, then the result would be P of D1 is equal to 6 given D2 is equal to 6. What would be then the probability? 6? No, 6 is no. 1 over 6? It would be 1, of course. So if these two dice are perfectly correlated, then you would get a 1. And then would you call these two guys independent? No. So now maybe you get a feeling of what independent means. Yeah. And yeah, an immediate consequence from this definition of independence is this little theorem that tells us P of A and B is P of A times P of B if A and B are independent. This is equivalent to our definition before. Now, oh yeah, here we have the proof, but you look at it at home, and it's even better that you find this trivial proof by yourself. It's really easy, but that's important to understand the connection between these two characterizations of independence. That's very important. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, let's look at, oh yeah, maybe we should stop now. Thank you.